Greetings. My name is Kim Beery, and I am the pastor here at Trinity United Methodist Church. I welcome you to our time of worship as we glorify God together and learn from the Holy Word. Please feel free to share our worship service with your friends on Facebook and leave a comment as feedback. Your participation is very important to us. Today is Mother's Day. Let us reflect upon the influence of the important women in our lives. They may be our biological mother or grandmother, or a chosen adopted mother, or a woman who fills a mothering role in the nurture of our lives, and much more. I encourage you to reach out to the special women in your life today to thank them for their influence and love. As we begin our worship, let us remember that the God who we are worshiping can fill us with new hope as we put aside our brokenness and confusion and surround ourselves with God's presence. Let us hear from the Psalms. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him, bless his name. Come, let us worship.
Everyone. My name is Carrie Ohlenberger. I am the Director of Family Ministries here at Trinity, and you're probably wondering why I'm standing on this ladder. Well, let me tell you. When I am on this ladder, I am about 8 feet tall, which is still about a foot shorter than Goliath was in the story, David and Goliath. And they wouldn't let me go any higher. And really, I don't know that I want to. I think that this story was one of my favorites when I was growing up because I was always short. In fact, until I was probably a junior in high school, I was always the shortest. And one of the things that I discovered about being short is that sometimes people don't have very high expectations for you. They never assumed I might be kind of a good athlete. And when I was really, really young, sometimes people assumed that I must be a lot younger, and so they would be surprised when I could actually read or speak well. Well, my son Brady has inherited my height. When he was younger, he was always the shortest in his class as well. And one of my favorite pictures of him, in my opinion, is a great modern day David and Goliath. You can see my number 26 here in this picture. This was taken of him when he was in about seventh grade playing as a defensive back in football. And I think we have another one. You can see him there on the left getting ready to take on his Goliath. And if you want to see how that picture turned out, well, you can see that he did take down his Goliath there. One of my favorite things that Brady said to me during this time was, he would say, "Mom, when I'm out there on the field, I forget how big I am." Now, incidentally, if you haven't seen Brady lately, and given our current situation, you probably haven't, he's now taller than me and continuing to grow. But I do know that some of these early experiences that he had made him the person that he is today, as it did with me. Especially in sports, he had to work twice as hard because many times there weren't a lot of expectations of him when a coach would first look at him. Well, the same thing goes for David in our story. He was a young teenager and so was probably about my height. Can you imagine what it would have been like to face a big, burly man that was probably twice his size? What faith in God that must have taken. I think it can teach us a lot that sometimes the people who we least expect can make the biggest impact. What about all of you? Especially maybe our younger people out there. We do have pretty high expectations of you because we know you can all do great things. So even if you're smaller or younger, or maybe you don't feel as strong as others, take some time this week to think about some of those big things that you can do and ask God for help. Would you pray with me? God, thank you for giving us courage and strength to face things that we don't always think we can face. Help us to remember that you are always with us. It is in your Son's name that I pray. Amen.
Carrie, thank you so much, and we're so glad that you made it down from that ladder safely. We come to the time in our service where we focus our hearts on prayer. Will you please join me in praying? Lord God, there are days when it seems like we are surrounded by giants, too large to slay. We feel helpless against the foes in our own lives and those at large in the world. What can we do to overcome hunger and persecution? What power do we have to end hatred and war? How do we beat back homelessness and unemployment in our community? How can a slingshot eliminate the fear, broken relationships, suffering, and grief in our lives? We yearn to be whole. We long to be at peace with ourselves, each other, and the world. As we wrestle, help us to remember these struggles are temporary. Remind us that you are a stronghold for the oppressed, and in times of trouble, remind us that if we rely on you, we need not fear anything. Instill in us a stronger faith. Fill us with your Spirit. inspire and guide us in ways to help spread your kingdom and to overcome the giants. Help us to find reconciliation and peace in you. Peace in you, the one who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This morning, we are happy to have with us Ayla Boo, and she will be singing Soar.
Here I remind myself what you said over me. Here I remind my soul who you are. You said you won't relent, won't let go, won't forget every promise you have whispered to my heart. As I wait, as I wait on you, I'm gonna run and not grow weary. I'm gonna every
Ayla, thank you so much for blessing us this morning. As you were singing, I kept thinking of those words that you were saying, and I'm wondering if that's what David was thinking. I will wait, and therefore I will conquer. Great job. Thank you so much. It's so wonderful having you join us in worship. Speaking of giants, I think we have a giant in the world around us right now. And that giant is having an impact in so many ways in our community and across the globe. One of the things that stands firm and one of the things that stands strong is Trinity United Methodist Church in our community. We continue our ministries within the church, and members of our church are reaching out into the community, serving on community leadership teams that are making decisions that are impacting our county and our state. The work of the church goes on. The work of the church has not stopped just because the doors are locked. The work of the church does not stop because between 8 and 5 o'clock, the doors are locked. The work of the church goes on 24 hours a day. The youth group continues to meet on Sunday evenings, not together, not in their beautiful new space, but on Zoom, having activities together and working together and learning together and fellowshipping together. The music ministry folks continue to meet on Thursday evenings. We meet on Thursday at 7 o'clock, and we are together, fellowshipping together and talking together and sharing joys and concerns. And then we go into breakout rooms, and we talk together, and we work together. Faye and Kim are on so many committees in our community, helping pave the path for the direction that we are going in the future. The work of the church continues in our community. And therefore, we need continued help from you in your offerings. Faye and Kim and Carrie and I were talking the other day about the current trend of offering in our church. And at this point, I would share with you, statistically, the trend in our church of giving from the first day we started this until today. The data would show that the trend is declining. But the work has not declined. The work that we are doing, preparing for when you all come back and join us, has not stopped. Join us and continue to give to the church, not to the church, but to the work of the church and the work of the church in our community. Because even though we're not coming together on Sunday mornings, we know that you are doing great work in our community. Thank you. For those of you who might have picked up our worship service and don't regularly attend here, please continue to give to your churches. There are ways here at Trinity that you can give, and you can give safely. First is by mailing a check to Trinity United Methodist Church at 1602 North Main Street in Hutchinson, Kansas, 67501. Or you can give safely on the internet on our website at trinityhutch.org. Both of those are ways that you certainly can share your giving with our church. We thank you as the ministries of our church continue.
Our scripture story today comes from the 17th chapter of 1 Samuel. Listen to the Message translation. David took his shepherd's staff, selected 5 small, smooth stones from the brook, and put them in the pocket of his shepherd's pack, and with his sling in his hand, approached Goliath. As Goliath paced back and forth, his shield bearer in front of him, he noticed David. He took one look down on him and sneered.
A mere youngster. Apple cheek and peach fuzzed.
The Philistine ridiculed David.
Am I a dog that you come after me with a stick?
And he cursed him by his gods.
Come on, I will make roadkill of you for the buzzards. I'll turn you into a tasty morsel for the field mice.
David answered,
"You come at me with sword and spear and battle axe. I come at you in the name of God of the angel armies, the God of Israel's troops, whom you curse and mock. This very day, God is handing you over to me. I'm about to kill you, cut off your head, and serve up your body and the bodies of your Philistine buddies to the crows and the coyotes. The whole earth will know that there's an extraordinary God of Israel, and everyone gathered here will learn that God doesn't save by means of sword or spear. The battle belongs to God. He's handing you to us on a platter."
That roused the Philistine, and he started toward David. David took off from the front line, running toward the Philistine. David reached into his pocket for a stone, slung it, and hit the Philistine hard in the forehead, embedding the stone deeply. The Philistine crashed face down in the dirt. That's how David beat the Philistine. With a sling and a stone, he hit him and killed him. No sword for David. Then David ran up to the Philistines and stood over him, pulled the giant's sword from his sheath, and finished the job by cutting off his head. When the Philistines saw that their great champion was dead, they scattered, running for their lives.
This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Have you ever been so scared that you wanted to run the opposite direction from a situation? I have to admit that I struggle when I try to face down personal giants in my life. I don't like conflict, and most of the time, I don't feel very brave. Sometimes when life goes bad, it's like watching a scary movie with your eyes shut, especially when danger is coming your way and your enemies clash. Slowly, you open your eyes to see how everything turned out, always hoping that the good guys won and confirming that you're still alive. As believers in a hope-filled God, how can our faith help us face obstacles and life's giants with new courage and strength? Today, I am going to meddle and inquire about the personal giants you're facing in your life right now. What makes you feel like running away? What scares you? What makes you want to shut your eyes and not look? Let us explore the scriptures to learn from the examples of God's servant, young David, as he faced down his giant with the help of God. Let us pray. Life-giving God, prepare our hearts to experience the important story of courage and strength through the example of David's confidence in your provisions and guidance. Open our hearts to new ways of hearing you, Lord, in the midst of our circumstances and life journey. For it is in Jesus' holy name that we pray. Amen. Today, we begin an 8-week sermon series about biblical heroes and courageous living. We will explore tools of creative bravery together, and you are also invited to join me in a Zoom Bible study this following Wednesday the 13th at 10 o'clock in the morning or 6:30 in the evening for deeper study. Through today's scripture story, I want to identify new tools to deal with fear and increase spiritual bravery. I'll be highlighting two concepts, the essence and the elements of frightful giants and spiritual courage. We will learn how to be confident, God confident, in the face of fear. Let's look at the spiritual hero David, who serves God in a mighty way, taking down a giant. At the age of 17, David is sent by his father to take some food to his brothers on the front lines of war between God's people and the Philistines. This day is an ordinary day for David, as he tended his flocks as a shepherd with his staff and slingshot. Who knew that that day God would use him, an ordinary teenager, in extraordinary ways to fell a giant? Now, David follows the instructions of his father. With groceries in hand, he walks to a standoff between the two armies. God's people and Saul's army were encamped in the green rolling hills surrounding the valley of Elah, which stands still today. The Philistines were constant enemies of Israel during this period, and they were assembled their army on one mountain opposite of the mountain where the army of Israel stood. The Philistines were a sea people who had iron swords and spears, and Israel was no match for them with weapons, mostly farm tools. This was a battle for the very existence of the nation of Israel. They had struggled against the Philistine for 200 years, a loss that would now cost them everything. And the people of Israel had grown tired of the struggle. I find it amazing to realize that sometimes miracles happen when we're tired and worn out. That morning, David came upon the camp just in time when the army was going out to its battle positions, shouting the war cry. Imagine the excitement of this young teenager. A real live war was going on right before his eyes. Shields up, swords flashing, men running. David ran right along with them, unarmed and carrying a bag of groceries. What a sight he was, screaming the war cry at the top of his lungs. The soldiers running beside him probably thought, who is this kid? And what's in that bag? About the time David found his brothers, he also discovered Goliath. Let's pause and imagine how you might have felt entering this tense, dangerous situation. Anyone want to turn around with me and go back home where it's safe? Well, both armies had been fighting in the valley for over 40 days. Twice a day, Goliath taunted the Israelites. Yes, that had been 80 times. It was humiliating and demoralizing. Day after day, night after night, Goliath screamed for a champion from the Israelites who would settle the conflict. That day, Goliath put his hands through his mouth and shouted across the narrow valley, "Hey, over there, I need a man to fight me." It was the 81st challenge. David, however, was hearing it for the very first time. That's when the whole situation changed. Unlike the Israelites who were concerned about their own safety, David was concerned about the reputation of his God. David recognized that the cause and purpose of God were at stake. That's why he volunteered to fight Goliath. So let me point out an important point. Courage is all about God and less about us. Now let me bring that down to a practical level. Think about it. When you're afraid, you can only usually think about your own survival or the people that you love around you. Maybe it's not a time when you think about God, unless you want to find an escape. I wonder what would change if we thought about God's presence and provisions first. The essence of giants in our lives is that they are overwhelming. Can you imagine how overwhelming just the sight of Goliath was? 9 feet tall, Carrie showed us how tall that was, proportionally around 600 pounds, carrying 125 pounds of armor, infantryman Goliath versus slinger David. That sounds pretty overwhelming to me. Yes, the giants in our lives can become overwhelming as our obstacles taunt us and yell out, "You can't do this. Give up. Run the other way." What do you identify in our culture right now that seems to be overwhelming? I'm still having a hard time wrapping my head around this pandemic thing and responding courageously, responsibly, and dealing with my giants, my fear. The characteristics of scary giants are that they make us believe that the situation is hopeless, overwhelming, and the taunts scream doubts into one's soul. Giants just seem to be overwhelming. You want to shut your eyes and hope that the situation, the movie, ends well. Being courageous is a spiritual perspective and a choice. It's usually the opposite of what we feel. Think about this. When you're worried, you want to stress more. You don't want to embrace peace. When you're afraid, courage is not natural. You just want to escape. When you're called to forgive someone, you sure don't feel like it. Well, the responses that we should choose will be the opposite of what we feel. And if we follow the example of David, we're going to run to our giants with the help of God. We'll learn how to be God-confident rather than self-confident. Too many people run the other direction when things seem to be hopeless. Not David. He trusted in the Lord to come to his aid. And David bravely confronted Goliath based on his belief in God. David stood alone with God in the valley. He left the faithless and fearless army of Israel behind. He left his brothers behind. He even left King Saul behind. And that in that one incredible moment, he became Israel's greatest hero. When he left home, he was a shepherd boy. By mid-morning, he was a national hero. Goliath stood there speechless. He hadn't heard an Israelite talk that way before. The giants told David he'd kill him and feed him to the birds. But David courageously replied that he would fight the giant in the name of the Lord and that the God of armies of Israel. When that stone hit the giant's forehead, he fell dead. He didn't even have to pick up the other four stones he picked up in the brook. One killed Goliath and set the entire Philistine army into retreat. So David killed the giant with the tools he used as a shepherd. Remember, he only had a sling, five stones, and a staff. He turned down the armor that was offered to him by King Saul. It was all too big. It didn't fit. So being courageous involves using our own personal tools to overcome our giants and to proclaim God's work. We have all gone through hardships and heartaches. God wants us to use our life experiences to fell giants. As a cancer survivor, I have a unique insight into new levels of courage. As an adult child who has lost both parents, I have an empathy that is deep that I did not have before, especially today, as I ache to see the smile of my mother and hear her call me honey one more time. You see, there are situations in our lives that can help us fight the giants. We have tools. We just need to look around and identify them. What are the tools that God wants you to use? There are no easy roads to victory. It takes faith and courage to face obstacles. David became a great leader because he knew God personally. The Bible calls him a man after God's own heart. He overcame great obstacles, learned from mistakes, and transformed character flaws to become Israel's greatest leader. I ask each of us today, how do we increase our faith? Is it time to reorder priorities to bring them into line with God's priorities? Is it time to finally get to know God personally and find our own faith? and find strength in God's presence and purpose for our lives? Have you asked the question, what is God's will for my spiritual life, my marriage, my relationships, my finances, time, and activities? What is the source of your courage? Or are we like Goliath, trusting in ourselves? We trust in our size, our budget, our high-tech equipment, our state-of-the-art programming, our history, and our heritage. Are we confident in our own selves, facing our giants with limited strength, relying only on human efforts? David was led by the Spirit of God, as Zechariah 4:6 states, not by might, not by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord Almighty. Jesus proclaimed in John 15, verse 5, I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. And the gospel reminds us that we cannot make it our own, but that Jesus has provided all we need. After all, Jesus said that a small amount of faith can move mountains. This is the kind of faith that saves, the kind that trusts in the mighty Spirit of the victorious Lord. What problem, what giant are you facing today? Remember that your problem is not bigger than what David faced. Well, let's put everything together. Courage is all about God, not us. And less about what we need and our own strength is what God wants us to do. Being courageous is a spiritual perspective and choice that involves using our life tools for God's work. Courage, with the help of God, overcomes any giants. Courage grows as we trust in God. Open your eyes. See God with you. The movie will end well with the help of God. Next week, we will look at the biblical hero, Joseph. I invite you to read Genesis chapter 37. Remember, God is present with you. Do not lose heart. Be strong and courageous and put your hope in the Lord. Amen.